Hey, what's up YouTube? In this video, I'll be giving an overview of a tool I built to paint a texture used in a light function, allowing you to literally paint light. You can specify a material. In my case, it's a light function applied to the directional light, which maps a static texture to world space using the min and max bounds of the desired area. And so this tool retrieves that texture and its mapping coordinates from the material, letting you paint, erase, and blur the texture with a simple brush. You can control the strength, falloff, and radius. Simple yet effective. Now I'll keep the video short since this relies on Scriptable tools, and I've already made a detailed video on how to create one from scratch. In fact, the tool itself is nearly identical to one I covered in a previous video where I showed how to paint a flow map in the editor with just a few adjustments. So I won't go over everything again, just enough to give you an idea of how it works. Alright, let's dive in. This blueprint is an editor scriptable click-drag tool. To create one, you need to enable both the Scriptable Tools framework and the Editor Mode plugins. When setting up the script, I add a property set to expose all the necessary settings, including the brush settings and the material interface I want to scan for the texture and mapping coordinates. These must be texture and vector parameters with names matching those defined in the settings. By default, this name is used for the texture, as you can see, and that one for the vector holding the min and max 2D world coordinates. Now, changing the material in the settings triggers a function that refreshes the paint context by closing and reopening it. More on these functions in a second. And that covers the tool setup. Next, in the overhit test function, which is provided by this class and can be overridden, I grab the hover position ray struct and perform a line plane intersection test with a plane facing the world z direction at an arbitrary z height. Since the texture we intend to modify maps using the x and y world coordinates, the z value is somewhat arbitrary. Thus, it's up to you to define the virtual plane height used to calculate the cursor's intersection point for painting, if that makes sense. This gives me a 2D position where the cursor intersects that virtual plane, essentially where the brush stroke will be applied when you click. The click event here is actually intentionally a click-drag event. That's how this Scriptable tool class works. You click and hold the left mouse button to paint and release it to stop. Makes sense, right? So on click, I call the startPaint function, which essentially opens the paint context. More on that in a second. Painting continues while dragging the mouse, and once the click is released, the painting operation is performed one last time. The endPaint function is only called on shutdown, which simply closes the paint context. Now, the context isn't closed when releasing the mouse, since opening and closing it involves a few costly operations, as you'll see in a moment. So I'd rather avoid doing that every single click. Also, using the script render event, I simply draw a circular brush by using a for loop to render a series of debug lines around the cursor position. So, to summarize, script setup defines the properties and monitors changes to the material property. Mouse hover performs a line trace under the cursor to find the intersection point against a virtual plane. With that intersection point, painting begins on a click, updates during drag, and ends when the drag stops. And that intersection point is also used to draw the cursor itself using draw debug lines. Let's dive a little deeper into the start, update, and end paint functions. Once again, the start function just calls the open paint context function if not yet opened. So the first thing we need to do is gather the necessary data and check if everything is ready to go. And well, let me tell you, it's a huge pain. Let me walk you through the challenge. So the user specifies a light function material, right? And right away, there are multiple scenarios to consider. It could be a material instance, or possibly even a material instance dynamic, though I'm not entirely sure about that possibility yet. But we'll handle it just in case. It's the simplest scenario anyway. Now, regardless of the material type, it may reference either a static texture or a render target. If it's a render target, then we're in luck, because we can right away paint onto it. However, if it's a static texture, then, well, that's where the problems begin. First, we'll need to copy that texture to a render target before we can paint onto it. And in order to see what we're painting, we'll need to update the material to use the render target, and later undo that once the painting is done. And depending on the material type, that can get complicated. So let's break it down. First, is the material a material instance dynamic? If so, great, we can try to retrieve its texture and vector parameters. Next, if it's just a regular material instance, we can attempt the same thing, retrieve the texture and vector parameters. But there's a catch. If the material instance does not override the texture and or vector parameters, they won't be part of those arrays. In that case, we'll need to check the parent material for its default parameter values. And if it's just a plain material, well, then same as the parent material, we can directly attempt to retrieve the material's default parameter values. Once we've done that, hopefully we've got the texture mapping world coordinates. From there, I can calculate the texture mapping extent and origin. Now, if the texture used in the material is a render target, we are good to go. We can paint directly onto it. But if it's a static texture, well, more work ahead. First, we create a render target with the same size and format. Then we need to copy the content from the static texture into the render target using a simple material that outputs just the texture. Essentially, this draws the static texture into the render target. Now, we need to actually see what we're painting, right? So if the material is a material instance dynamic, I can easily temporarily switch its texture parameter to point to our render target. Once we're done, I'll undo that change when closing the paint context. If it's a material dynamic, I can update the texture parameter as long as it's overridden. But if not, I'll have to update the parent material instead. Finally, if it's just a material, I'll have to update it as well. And that's where things start to get even more tricky. I ended up brute forcing it with a small Python script because I don't think there's a proper solution in UI without using third-party plugins or blueprint libraries. It works, but it's kind of sketchy and slow. So if you know a better solution, I'd love to hear it. The goal is to find and update this material texture expression within the material asset. I use an object iterator to go through all existing material expressions in the project. Yeah, told you it was sketchy. Next, I check if the path of the material expression object starts with our material's path. If it does, that means it's part of the material, right? Thus, if the parameter name matches the one we are looking for, great, it's probably the texture object or texture sample material expression we need to update to point to our render target. However, this texture parameter could also be bundled inside a material function. In that case, the texture expression we are after might not include the material path in its own path. So to handle this, while looking for the texture expression, I also build a list of all material function expressions that are part of the material. If we can't find the texture expression this way, directly within the material, we try again. This time scanning all texture-based expression objects that share one of our material function paths. If we find a texture material expression that shares a path with one of the material function expressions in our material, and that texture matches the name we are looking for, then we've found our texture asset. At that point, we update it to point to our render target while painting. We also output the success of this function along with the actual texture expression that was updated, so we don't have to search for it again when we revert the changes upon closing the paint context. The final and important step is to recompile the material. Finally, we create a material instance dynamic of our brush material and update its texture parameter to reference the render target. And that's it. Regardless of the material type or texture type, we should now have a light function material that points to a render target. One that we will be able to update because it is also referenced in our paint material instance dynamic. And this paint material instance dynamic is then used during the paint update. First, I again perform a line plane intersection test to find the updated cursor position on our virtual plane. Next, I forward the brush's XYZ position and various brush settings, like strength, radius, falloff, modes, depending on various inputs, and properties, to the material instance. Then I draw the material onto the render target. We are painting. So the final piece of the puzzle, what does this material actually do? First, based on the texture mapping coordinates we retrieved from the material, I convert the texture coordinates from unit to world space. This lets me create a sphere mask in world space using the cursor's position in world space, radius in centimeters, and the brush falloff. This is our brush-based mask. Now, depending on the keys pressed, painting additively is as simple as adding that sphere mask to whatever is already stored in the render target. For erasing, well, depending on the eraser mode, we either subtract or multiply. Literally that, just subtract or multiply. For blurring, I won't dive too deep, but basically, for every pixel in the brush, I sample nearby pixels to apply a Gaussian blur. It's a bit costly, but not a huge concern for an offline tool. And that's it. To summarize, when you click, if the context isn't already opened, we do that first. If needed, we update the provided material to point to a temporarily created render target, which is a copy of the current static texture used in the material, assuming the material uses a static texture instead of a render target to begin with. During update, we sample that render target, and depending on the operation, we either add or subtract a sphere mask or brush to it. Or blur it, whatever operation you want to perform. This is a feedback loop, right? The output of this material becomes the next input of that same material, so you can keep adding to it or removing from it, you get the idea. To conclude, when ending the paint context, usually during tool shutdown, I revert the changes. Meaning, if the texture we initially scanned in the material was a static texture, and it was replaced by a render target, it needs to be updated. So first, cache its current settings, then convert the render target to a static texture, which will override the existing texture. Reapply the settings and optionally release the render target. Next, if we did indeed change the material in any way, undo that. It comes down to determining whether the static texture asset of the material, material instance, or material instance dynamic was replaced with our temporary render target, and if so, restoring the original, now updated texture asset. Finally, clear all references, and voila. Oof, quite a puzzle, but it works. It works with a material that uses a static texture, see? It works with a material instance that uses a static texture, whether that texture is overridden in the instance or not. And it even works with a material that uses a render target, and so on. No, know, I'm not exactly a big fan of modifying the actual material or material function to ping-pong between a render target and the original static texture. I always worry about doing any kind of modification to original assets. Who knows, if something isn't implemented correctly, permanent changes could be made. But oh well, I suppose that's a necessary evil here. Let's pray I implemented everything correctly. Voila! I hope this gave you some insight into one possible way to paint onto a texture directly in the editor using Scriptable tools. The files are available as a tier 2 reward on my Patreon. Thanks for watching and thanks to my patrons for their ongoing support. If you enjoyed the video, consider leaving a like and subscribing to the channel. I'll see you in the next one. Take care of yourself. Bye bye!